Even the closely hasn't smelled it.
Jeg synes samtidig, at det smager gerne og gode.
Skål. Hvis du er klar. Velkommen. Tak.
Hello and welcome to Cimbrer Bushcraft. Yeah, today I'm in my camp, you can see, and I brought Martin from Northern Woodsman with me. He's the first time he's out here seeing my Viking house. Yeah. So, and you saw I have my banner up and everything, also my helmet up. So everything is Viking Bushcraft today. It's not going to be a long video, I think. And it will only be out here. I'll tell you a couple of things, among them, of course, about the theft and the thief that I finally caught. So, and some other stuff I would like to show you. I have some questions from my viewers about some of the things I have made, and I will tell you a little bit about that, the construction of it, and so on. But I hope you'll stay on, and I hope you enjoy this little day out here in Cimbrer Camp with my new Viking house. Unfortunately, we couldn't make an overnighter at this moment because of many reasons, but we'll be back sometime, I think, in May, and making an overnighter out here, and perhaps something Viking overnighter before that. That's what we are talking about, Martin and I. So, yeah, the weather is okay, it's no wind, and it's a little bit cloudy, but really warm and cozy out here. And of course, I'm going to make my coffee, and today it will be a special coffee. And I'll talk about that a little bit later. Yeah. And as you saw in my video title, I found out who was behind the theft I've been having out here in my Cimbrer camp. I actually caught him on camera. I won't show you the footage because it's not legal in Denmark to show footage of persons, regardless if they are criminals. So, but my thumbnail, you can see a picture where he's going down the hill with some of my stuff. Yeah, well, I caught him on camera, and I actually went to a little town that is very near my Cimbrer camp and showed the picture to a couple of people and asked them if they knew who he was. And one of them told me his name and where he lived, so I actually went out to him and confronted him with my theft, and he didn't deny anything. He was very stunned, and he didn't say much. It was a surprise for him that I had a camera. He stole my first trail camera out here a long time ago, and you know I got my new rear link up here. So I caught him on camera. He's a man about 50 years old. I think he's fond of alcohol and drinking a lot. And I think he's out here because here he can sit down and drink alcohol. And some reason he had taken all my stuff. So and I asked him why, and he couldn't tell me that. And I actually tried to make him, to convince him that he should bring the things back to me, and then I wouldn't contact the police. And I gave him a good long time for that. It's actually 1 month since I got him on camera. So he has a month, he has had a month to bring the stuff back, and he promised to do that, but I haven't seen him, and I've been out for him, and I've been out to him several times to see if I could get it back, but yeah. I don't know why. So now I contact the police, and I'll see what they can do, if they will do anything. It's about 3,000 kroners of stuff I'm lost out here, so it's not cheap for me, and it's a lot of things that I have bought over a long time, and I really like all the stuff that he took. So. Yeah, and the last time he was out here, he actually took a thing down in my fire pit that I have to cover the fire when I'm leaving the camp or when I'm sleeping out here. Not a big thing and not expensive at all, but he took that too, and I don't know why. And my white tarp that I have out here when I'm making an overnight, where I've been putting in a zipper in, he took that too, and he can't explain why. And I asked him if he had sold my things, and he said no. Where is it? I asked him, and he said roundabouts, and he won't specify that. So now we must see. The police, I think there'll be some weeks before they will actually take action for this, and I don't know what they are going to do. So, but I'm glad I found him. I thought it was some young people that was interested in my gear and think they were cool, but a man that 50 years old and driving a scooter, I don't know why. But since I found him, and he know there's a video camera out here, he hasn't been back, and I hope he won't. I think he's been scared so much now that he won't return. I hope so. And it gives me a little bit more calm when I'm watching my footage out here from the camp. I'm not so anxious anymore, because I don't think he'll be back. So that's a good thing. And well, I have to buy the stuff again, especially the white tarp. It was a good solution, but out here in my camp, making an overnighter, and it was cold. So now it is summer, and I can easily stay out here without anything in front of my shelter. Yeah, and while Martin is preparing the firewood for our coffee, I'll tell you a little bit about some stuff I have. I got some question regarding this one, my little fire stand for my fire bowl, and people ask me how I did it, and it's actually not a difficult thing to make. I made it of brass because I love brass, but you can make it from different kind of materials, it doesn't matter. The trick is this one inside the middle here. You can see how it's attached. This is just tubes from brass, and I put a screw through that and into this. And I made this so you can see how it looks. I made this, and then I cut it out in brass, and you have to bend it here. And that's the big thing, because it's not easy to bend this. But when you bend it down here, you have these holes you can attach the poles to, and then you'll have a little tripod that is like this, you can use for your fire bowl. Yeah. And I came up with this solution because it was the most simple one, and it actually functions very well. So just make a triangle, and these small triangles there, then you can bend, and then attach these tubes to it, and then you have a little fire stand. And it's reasonably compact. You can see I can transport it in my pack frame with no trouble there, and I put it up, and again it protects my the ground from my fire. I think it's a very nice little thing to have. When I'm out on the Viking hikes, I use my little Opinel saw, and now I'm using my fire bowl. It's not good anymore, because I'm going to have some larger wood to the fire bowl. So that's the reason why I made this little saw. It's a box saw. I made it in, I think it looks a little bit Viking, like with this bent up here. The saw blade is from the Agave Canyon, 15 inch. I took that, and I hope that Agave will give me a saw blade that I can put on that. But it was perfect for my use. You can see it's not a big saw, it's a handsaw, but it will go through wood that is a little bit larger than the one I can manage with my little Opinel saw. So I hope you think it is a nice little saw. I just, of course, I can put it apart. You can see here. And I'll take this out. It doesn't take much room. I just have to make a little bag for this. Yeah. And I made this one on the place where the saw blade is, because it will take the pressure of the wood. I think it's a good solution there. Yeah. So my little new Viking saw. I know the Viking didn't use saw in the Viking age, but it's a wonderful thing to have when you are producing firewood to your evening and nights. I actually made a little video about how I made this saw. It's not a complete DIY or a tutorial about. I just have some highlights I would like to show you so we can see some of the steps in this process. Yeah. I hope you find that interesting. Just a little thing, perhaps you can be inspired to make something similar if you think that is a good way to make a little saw for you. And another question I've got is regarding my little Viking hood. It's called a Skjoldham hood. It's from a findings in a town called Skjoldham. I think it is Norway. And people ask me how I am going to, how I did this, how I made this. And it's actually not so difficult. I'll put a, you can see here, a little template on how you are going to do that. It's actually only three pieces of fabric you need. You need the long one that is going from beneath and all the way up and down here. And I put the measuring in that I've used for my body. It's a big body I have, so if you're smaller, you have to make that smaller. And then I just had to make two square pieces here that I put in the front and in the back, and sawed together here in the back. And in the front, of course, there's a place you can have your head on. So it's actually very easy to make. And again, the drawings that I have, I found on the internet.
Yeah.
And then my good friend Sean from Alberta in Canada sent me all this stuff you can see here. Thank you very much, Sean. I really appreciate that. You're always so kind. And you can see a CD with some music. And Sean actually know the artists that are making that music, and he's had the artist to sign my CD. I'm very grateful for that too. And it's great music. And some bars I can take with me out when I'm on my hikes, and some coffee.
Yeah,
very special. It's this coffee, and it's called Ace, but not that black pepper smoky coffee. And I'm really looking forward to taste this, and this is actually the coffee that Martin and I are going to taste today. So I'm looking forward to that. And the thing I was most excited about was, of course, this little pipe. Yeah. Isn't it nice? It's a Viking pipe. I know Viking didn't smoke in the Viking age, but nevertheless, it's a cool little pipe. Or a cool large pipe. You can see here, it's so small. It's almost like a peace pipe from the Indians. And the guy who has made this awesome pipe is has a comedy called The Barefoot Viking. And he has an Instagram account. So you actually can buy this pipe and other types of stuff he's making. It's all Viking inspired, and it's a really cool little shop. Of course, I put a link so you can find it, and perhaps something that you would like to buy. And then I'll talk about these little symbols that is on this pipe. Look at this. Isn't it beautiful? And this symbol, of course, runes. And this one is meant to be for wealth, energy and luck. So that's the sign for that. And the on the other side, this symbol is for comfort, harmony and friendship. Yeah. So two good signs, rune sign on this pipe. And I've decided I'll wait to smoke on it until my next Viking video. I think that's the best thing. This is a pipe I'll use on my Viking trips. Yeah. I don't know how it's going to perform, but I'll give it a try, and I'll always have it with me. So cool. Thank you very much, Sean, and the guy that made this. Yeah, he's a true artist. Go in and check him out. I put a link below his Instagram and his Etsy accounts. Yeah.
Ja, det håber jeg da egentlig, jeg gør op til. Må ikke.
der kappe.
Nå ja, den er den der. Au, for helvede.
Ja, yeah. Martin has bought his first billy can, zebra billy can, and we are going to make coffee in that today. So, and this is the coffee from Sean that I'm going to put in. I grind it back home, coarse grind, and there's a lot of coffee here I can see. So, I think, well, let's make it a strong coffee, yeah? Yeah. I think that will do, and then we add a little salt.
Do you want me to stir it now?
No.
No?
I actually saw a video on YouTube, an old guy that told how this cooking coffee is made.
Yeah.
And it is almost the way I do it. You come the grains in, and then you don't stir it. And when it begins to boil, you have to be careful that it not boil over. And when the grains, it's make a foam, and when the foam is gone and the grains are, well, sunk to the bottom, then you can drink it. You have to let it rest for a minute or two, but you can put cold water in, but as I used to say, it doesn't matter. For me, I can't see any difference between adding cold water or not. I don't have any grains in my coffee. So put the coffee grounds in and let it be on the top. And when it begins to boil, it'll make a foam and then it will sink to the bottom. And then you have your coffee. It's a good way to make cooking coffee, and you can do that with all kinds of coffees. Just have to grind it, coarse grind.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, and today is almost a Q&A video because I was the other day I got a question about my pipe, how I put the tobacco in. The guy that asked me is a beginner. And he makes it so he has to lit it all the time, and some are doing it wrong because there's no you can't soak in air here because it is too stuffed in this pipe. So today I'll show you how I do it, and this is for all kind of tobacco. The most important thing is that you start little at the time, so don't take a lot, take a little at the time, and then if you have something you can use for push it down, it will be better, but I often use my fingers to do that. But in the start it's good that you have something, so very gentle, press it down and add a little bit at a time. If you take a whole lot of tobacco in the beginning, it will usually stop here, and you'll have a gap in the bottom. There's no tobacco in because it's like a cork down here. So a little bit at the time. And don't fill it up to the edge, because when you light it, the tobacco will rise. And if you come all the way up here, the tobacco will rise and fall down and perhaps make some marks on your clothing or whatever you're wearing. So this is how I do it. And then many are telling me that I should use matches, and I began to use matches, but today I have my Zippo lighter with me. And then I'll try to light it up here. You can see it beginning to rise, so stuff it down. Yeah, Yeah, now it's going. And now it's important. After a time you have to do this almost every time you're smoking on it, because the tobacco that you are burning in the top will eventually not reach the tobacco beneath it. So the pipe will probably go out, and you're not able to smoke on it. So every time you puffed on it several times, you take a pin or something, you can buy stuff that glists, and stamp it down. Then you will all the time have a pipe that you can smoke on, and no problem there. And again, using a pipe cleaner is a good thing, because there'll be some liquid down here, some fluid, that will taste not very good. And if you're a new smoker on tobacco, on pipe, you have to be prepared that the first couple of weeks it will probably feel a little bit strange, and your tongue will hurt a little bit, but that's normal, and after a couple of weeks it will go over. And I've smoked pipe many years and I don't have that problem anymore, but a new pipe smoker will probably have that experience. Don't stop there, just keep on, and it will eventually be all right to smoke. So, yeah, hope this helped a little bit. I like and enjoy my smoking my pipe. I use Red Orlik Golden Slice tobacco, and it's a good tobacco. You can buy sweet tobacco, and that's great too, but I get tired of them, and I want a neutral tobacco, and that's Red Orlik. It's a very fine tobacco for that, and I smoke it every day. Yeah, a little answer for a question. I hope others will find that interesting too. Yeah. And now I think our coffee is almost ready, so we can have a little, you know, yeah. Yeah. And now we can see the foam.
Yeah.
And it's actually good to show it on this pot, because I can't see it in my kettle. So here you can see. And again, you have to be careful, it's not boiling too much. I raise it a bit. And then the foam will disappear. A little bit at a time. Yeah. Raise it a bit. You see down there, the foam is gone and the coffee is ready.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Have to rest again. But looking forward to taste this coffee from Sean. Pepper and smoky taste. It sounds delicious.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you. That's nice.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you.
You're welcome.
And cheers.
Cheers and welcome, Martin, for my new Viking house.
Yeah, it looks really
good. It's not a long house, it's a short house.
It's a short house, yeah. But it looks really nice.
Yeah,
really
thank
good.
You. I'm looking forward to making an overnight out here.
Yeah. That's gonna be cool.
Yeah, it's a good coffee. Yeah. I like it. It's a bit strong.
Yeah.
Perhaps I put too much in, I don't know, but it's strong and it's very tasty. A little bit flavor of smoke.
Yeah.
And pepper, I can taste it's a little bit strong.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's a pepper, but it tastes very delicious. Mmm. Oh yeah.
Yeah, it's really good.
Yeah.
You can also, I think you can taste the pepper in it.
Yeah, a little bit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now it's got salt and pepper, it's like a beef.
Salt and pepper coffee. Yeah. I haven't thought of that. Hmm?
Mm.
Well, Martin also made some footage out here today. He had some stuff he has to film. Was it only for Instagram or for YouTube?
Yeah.
Only Instagram. So go in and check his Instagram account and his YouTube account, Northern Woodsman. I put a link in my video description. You can find him. His videos are getting better and better, and I'm actually very proud of him because he has made a good step in gaining more subscribers. And if you like it, go in and subscribe to his channel too.
Well,
he needs that.
I got a good teacher.
But it's really nice to have you again with me, Martin.
Cool. On that.
Skål, brother. Yeah. Mm. Well, folks, this was all for now. Thank you for watching Cimbrer Bushcraft. This was a short video, I think, but I did answer some questions that some of my wonderful subscribers have asked me, and show you a new gift from Sean Watt from Alberta, Canada. He's a friendly guy, and I appreciate that. Yeah. Hope you enjoyed it, although there were no actually bushcrafting in. A lot of information, and I'm glad you joined me. So from Martin and I, see you on the next one. Bye bye and take care.